Item number, SCP-196. Object class, Euclid/Keter. Special containment procedures. SCP-196 must be kept wholly ignorant of any information regarding the reason for his containment. The subject is to be kept in a two-room cell inside Site 17. The cell is to be furnished with whatever SCP-196 requests, as long as the request does not show any obvious likely lethal use, and does not violate any SCP procedure. Subject must cohabit with at least one member of the Site's Level 2 security personnel, who must be armed exclusively with non-lethal weaponry. Subject is allowed to freely wander the installation if accompanied by at least one member of Site 17's security personnel. Note that all staff below Level 3 have been told he is a safe class object. SCP-196 has agreed to wear a satellite tracking anklet. Subject was told that removal of this anklet would result in his death, but this is not actually the case. SCP-196 displays no extraordinary physical ability, thus probability of escape is negligible. Description: SCP-196 appears to be a middle-aged male, under 2 meters tall, of African-American descent. He claims to be 47 years old. Subject has black hair and brown eyes. There are no abnormal physical characteristics. Subject displays all basic needs of a normal human being. Subject tested with an IQ of 109, well within normal parameters. Subject's psychological examination indicated that he suffers from institutionalization and Stockholm syndrome in relation to the Foundation's security staff. SCP-196 demonstrates no Euclid type or other abnormal abilities. Note: I've run the full battery of tests, and the exam says the guy is normal. Dr. Addendum 196-1. SCP-196's origin and subsequent Keter classification. SCP-196 appeared inside of Site. Date undisclosed. SCP-196 claims he was recruited through standard Class D recruitment procedures for testing of SCP. Subject also claims that his younger self is currently living in another location in. Genetic identification checks confirm that SCP-196 has encountered Foundation security personnel in the past, in an incident at Site 17, in 1960. During that incident, SCP-196 was far older, and was killed by SCP security personnel during an attempted break-in at that facility. SCP-196 was, at that time, not known to the Foundation as anything other than a lone human assailant. However, he was found to be carrying SCP and several purely mundane weapons. While a Euclid class event of this nature would normally result in an individual being terminated to prevent any potential for a catastrophic paradox, SCP-196's future self is already dead. This means that if he were permitted to die, a catastrophic paradox could occur, damaging or destroying this continuity. SCP-196 must be kept alive until he decides to and successfully manages to escape of his own accord, and somehow travels back to experience his own death while carrying SCP. Note that because of the potential for paradox, SCP-196 must be kept far away from his younger double. Additionally, a covert observation team must be permanently attached to SCP-196's younger self to protect his life. This dedicated security force should otherwise not intervene. Failure to permit the timeline from unfolding naturally could result in damaging or destroying this continuity. For these reasons, SCP-196, despite being otherwise mundane, must be carefully monitored and has been classified as a Euclid/Keter class object.
Item number, SCP-036. Object class, safe. Special containment procedures. Once every year, a mobile task force is dispatched from Containment Command 02 and data expunged to Site 22A to defend the runway and airport located there. The civilian facility is to be cleared of all non-SCP personnel by 0400 hours of September 23rd, and none are allowed to return until sunrise the next day. On October 1st, all civilians must be evacuated again before sunrise, and will not be allowed on to Site 22A until the return of the pilgrimage flight. Pilgrims in transit from the arrival flight, awaiting departure on the pilgrim flight, may only be cross-examined by researchers with level 3 security level clearance or higher. Description: SCP-036 includes the location Site-22A, a small airport in the Mosul region of northern Iraq, and Site-22B, the destination of passengers boarding at Site-22A. The key components of SCP-036 are the arrival flight, a passenger plane that varies in make and model from year to year, that arrives shortly before dawn on September 23rd. It appears on radar about 30 to 40 kilometers away from Site-22A. When it lands, pilgrims exit the plane and enter the terminal. No crew have ever left the plane. Observations have only revealed a masked pilot and co-pilot. This plane leaves quickly after pilgrims exit. It does not wait for clearance for takeoff, nor does it identify itself upon approaching for landing. The pilgrims. People of the Yazidi faith that exit the arrival plane, who are said to be undergoing the Kiras Gurahin. Each year, they are examined and identified as various people of the Yazidi faith that have died during the previous year. This is done through birth certificates, photo IDs, specific knowledge questions, and when possible, fingerprinting. Most have been known to be friendly and amicable, though most are reluctant to give details about the Kiras Gurahin. In the past, all have shown to be unable to recognize family and friends, or been able to remember any information beyond what short-term memory would normally allow. In the late afternoon of September 23rd, most pilgrims begin to emphasize how important it is that their pilgrimage must begin. At that time, they file onto the pilgrimage flight plane and depart, never to be seen again. The pilgrimage flight. A passenger plane provided by SCP personnel for the transport of the pilgrims. It is manned by a crew of trained Yazidi holy men. The crew are typically never able to elaborate upon details of the pilgrimage, or what the Kiras Gurahin actually is. SCP equipment on board function optimally, but recorded data will only slightly increase our understanding of the pilgrimage each year. Though the flight is gone for 7 days, the crew and recorded data are only able to account for a few hours. Days are missing from time recording equipment and cameras, though nothing abnormal is ever observed. The plane disappears from radar and visual contact is lost about 50 to 60 kilometers away from Site-22A until it returns about sunrise on October 1st. Site-22B, the destination of the pilgrimage plane. It is a small airport consisting of a runway and single building located at coordinates data expunged. It has only ever been observed by pilgrimage crew and cameras on the plane. It does not appear on satellite images, and attempts to reach it on foot have failed, once with disastrous results. Cameras have trouble focusing on the area, as the heat from the ground usually causes a mirage-like visual effect on all objects more than a few dozen meters from the plane. A flyover with an SCP reconnaissance plane several weeks before the pilgrimage revealed undeveloped land and what looked like an ancient stone statue. In the 1990s, SCP Mobile Task Force Sigma-4 attempted to reach Site-22B during the time of the pilgrimage. Upon the approach, communication was lost, and the task force was never heard from again. No other exploration attempts are advised during the 7-day pilgrimage. Originally, the Kurdish-speaking Yazidi people around Mosul secretly performed the pilgrimage themselves. Pilgrims from the east were escorted by masked armed guards on camel back into the care of Yazidi holy men. It has been explained that the holy men would then take the pilgrims west to their land of the dead, where the pilgrims would wait to be reborn back into the Yazidi people. The Kiras Gurahin, literally Kurdish for changing garments, is used to describe the belief of reincarnation that lesser souls of the Yazidi undergo. While this actual pilgrimage was done in secret, a symbolic pilgrimage and Kiras Gurahin are performed every year at this time by other Yazidi. During the 1960s, land acquisition by Kurds and Muslims, attacks by Turks, and punitive laws by the Islamic Iraqi government restricted the movements and customs of the Yazidi. During that time, the Foundation stepped in and offered aid in the way of an advantageous clause that granted SCP planes unrestricted access to airport facilities in the area. Almost immediately, mysterious planes carrying pilgrims from the east began landing at the local airport, and an elusive airport at the destination appeared as well.
Item number, SCP-052. Object Class,
Euclid. Special Containment Procedures. Although it is not possible to remove SCP-052 from the New York subway system, its predictable behavior allows the Foundation to prevent the public from encountering it. The 59th Street A, B, C, D station is to be closed to the public from 11 p.m. to 1 a.m. on Saturdays and Sundays, under the pretext of track maintenance. During that time, the station is to be staffed with agents from Mobile Task Force Gamma 6. Agents have been ordered to prevent accidental public access to the station, and to capture anyone seen leaving SCP-052. Anyone who has been on SCP-052 must be transported to Site-21 for debriefing and processing. Members of the public who see SCP-052 may be released after the administration of a Class B amnestic. Description: SCP-052 is a Type R4 New York City subway train. Official records indicate this train was built in 1932 and decommissioned for scrap in 1975. Nevertheless, it continues to appear on the Uptown AD track at the 59th Street and 8th Avenue station at 11:57 p.m. every Saturday. The train is in perfect condition and labeled as an A train. SCP-052 appears at the designated time, opens its doors to accept and discharge passengers for approximately 5 minutes, then closes its doors and disappears. It does not appear to ever contain passengers, except for those leaving the train during its appearance. The majority of subjects that have boarded SCP-052 have not been recovered. Passengers leaving SCP-052 claim to have boarded on various dates, from 1976 up to 2204. The latter claims he thought SCP-052 was a 300th anniversary special train. Subjects retain no knowledge of time on board. Addendum: passengers leaving SCP-052 must be brought to Site-21 and interrogated to determine their origin and possible threat to the current time stream. Generally, passengers from the past may be given Class A amnestics and reintegrated into society. Passengers from the future must be held indefinitely. Site-21 currently holds 26 recovered passengers. Despite our protocols to prevent public access, we are still receiving subjects from the future. Although some are from alternate timelines, it is possible SCP-052 will begin to appear at another time and place, requiring expanded containment. The Foundation has placed several subjects onto the train in an attempt to understand its activities when not visible. Test 052-1, May 31st, 2009. Agent placed on train, not recovered as of present date. Test 052-2, June 6th, 2009. Agent enters train, not recovered, as he apparently returned to 1980 and was killed in a confrontation with. Test 052-3. See notes on recovered passenger 052-4. After test 052-3, O5 Command issued orders that no further agents should be risked as passengers on SCP-052. Consideration has been given to using Class D personnel in their place, but the risk of releasing them into the past is too great. Log of recovered passengers in Foundation custody. Passenger 052-1. Entered train July 14th, 2012. Recovered March 8th, 2008. Notes: an accountant, on the way home from the theater when she entered the train, 052-1 has expressed surprise and dismay to have traveled back in time 4 years, but appears to be otherwise unchanged and unharmed. She has been determined to currently exist in this timeline and must be held indefinitely to prevent unwanted temporal effects. Passenger 052-2. Entered train June 12, 1976. Recovered March 15, 2008. Notes: subject entered train when lost on the way to Studio 54. Although unharmed and not a temporal threat, 052-2 is being held as the examining psychiatrist believes 32 years is too long a period over which to facilitate successful reintegration. Passenger 052-3. Entered train December 6, 2014. Recovered June 20th, 2009. Notes: a tourist from Jacksonville, Florida. Subject 052-3 now speaks Albanian instead of English. Held due to O5 orders regarding subjects from the future, as well as possible reintegration difficulties. Passenger 052-4. Entered train June 13th, 2009. Recovered June 27th, 2009. Notes:
Agent from test 052-3. Agent returned with his hand surgically removed and a note in his pocket with the message, "Send no more." Subject does not remember his experience on the train, but when subjected to hypnosis, revealed, data expunged. Passenger 052-5. Agent entered train at unknown future date in violation of protocol. On July 11th, 2009, body of subject was violently thrown from the train, landing 10 meters away. On examination, subject was found to have been data expunged. Whether security should be increased to prevent subject from entering SCP-052 is under consideration. Passenger 052-6 claims to be a level 4 supervisor from the SCP Federation, who entered the train in December 2124. Subject had been administered a Class A prime amnestic prior to boarding, in a successful attempt to avoid the fate of passengers 052-4 and 052-5. Recovered February 6, 2010. As he will never be released from Foundation custody, O5 Command has approved sharing otherwise classified information about other artifacts in our possession, in hopes of gaining new methods of containment and becoming aware of future security breaches. Agent has been cooperative and claims that it is good we do not know how to open SCP-699. Subject turned visibly pale and refused to discuss this item further. To be a survivor of the Great Zombie Plague of 2092 caused by an SCP-008 containment breach. That SCP can be killed by data expunged. Permission to try this has been denied by O5. That he worked for Dr. Jack Bright.
Item number, SCP-130. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. SCP-130 is to be staffed by 12 D-class, 6 security agents, level 2/130, and 1 researcher, level 3/130, twice per day, starting at 1/2 hour before local sunrise and sunset. All staff are to be appropriately uniformed. When not staffed, 2 security agents will remain in the lobby, and 2 additional agents will patrol within the building. Agents are advised not to prevent people from entering the lobby, but to notify MTF Alpha 4, Pony Express, to intercept anyone who receives mail or a package. Twice per day, bundles, SCP-132, will appear in the mail room. The parcels within the bundles are to be sorted by uniformed staff into appropriate bags and placed in a designated vehicle for transport to site. Should mail arrive with the following addresses, follow procedure Franklin 16, detailed in Addendum 132. Otherwise, mail will be checked under standard practices for any items of interest. Objects are not to be placed for outgoing mail unless certified orders are given by O5. Procedure Franklin 17 outlines the protocol used in these cases. Should anyone else enter SCP-130 to use the outgoing mail slot, they are to be permitted to do so, then intercepted by MTF Alpha 4 as soon as possible for questioning. The incident is to be reviewed through security tapes, and the outgoing mail watched for subsequent bundles and checked through the list of previous parcels received. Description: SCP-130 is a post office in an undisclosed location in South Africa, constructed in 18... SCP-130 had been closed and left abandoned for a number of years. The building is in excellent condition for its age, and maintains itself without human intervention, including moderate structural repairs. SCP-130 has been designated a historic site through an agreement with the South African government. 5 times per week at local sunrise and sunset, several bags and boxes will appear in the mailroom. The bundles, designated SCP-132, will show only on weekdays, with the exception of current postal holidays. Bundles are to be handled as per special containment procedures as above. Inside of the lobby, along with the post office boxes, is a slot labeled for outgoing mail. The slot is able to accept packages up to 40 centimeters wide and 6 centimeters high, with no apparent limit for length. Once inserted into the slot, packages disappear, and will eventually turn up in the outgoing mail bundles, if they have not done so previously. Addendum 131. SCP-130 came to the attention of the Foundation in 19... when packages and letters began to be circulated bearing the postmark for the site. The parcels appeared in post offices throughout the world with correct postage for delivery either locally or internationally, depending on the parcel.
The parcels were often undeliverable, either to non-existent addresses or to recipients who were not at the address, and so ended up in dead letter offices. Various Foundation assets noted the odd postmark, and Mobile Task Force Alpha 4 mobilized to investigate. MTF Alpha 4 arrived in where they discovered the town had mostly been abandoned decades ago. The post office appeared to be in excellent condition, not only well-maintained, but clean. While MTF Alpha 4 searched, bundles of mail appeared in the mailroom. Agents searched the bundles and discovered a variety of letters, parcels, and packages, all with that day's date and the postmark for that post office. A Foundation agent attempted to open one of the parcels, which resulted in the agent vanishing from sight. 6 days later, a package appeared in Sight's mailroom. Inside of it was said agent, and an envelope with a receipt for postage due. The agent had returned to sender and postage due tattooed on their back and was in a comatose state. Agent remained in that state until the envelope was delivered to SCP-130's outgoing mail slot, whereupon the agent returned to consciousness with no recollection from the time of disappearance. Similar results also occurred when agents tried to take away or damage either the parcels or the post office itself. Further investigation led to the current containment procedures, where D-Class personnel sort through the mail when it appears. Once processed and put in a marked vehicle, the mail can then leave the area unmolested. If the bundles are untouched, however, the bundles will vanish and later appear in the postal systems of the world in order to be delivered. Addendum 132. Through examination of the mail parcels over the past several years, research has shown certain trends. Over 1% of the mail is of a mundane nature, except for the matter of the postmark. Exceptions to this are letters that were apparently unsent, for whatever reason, and temporally displaced letters. The former, while odd, will be destroyed in order to protect the nature of SCP-130. Letters addressed to Foundation sites or personnel are to be sent to Site, where they will be reviewed. Procedure Franklin 16. When mail is specifically addressed to, the mail is to be sealed in a case with active countermeasures and brought to the office of the present level 5/130 supervisor. Mail will then be screened for possible explosive, chemical, biological, mimetic, or any and all threats. After screening, the mail will be opened and assessed. While no new artifacts requiring secure containment have arrived, the possibility cannot be ignored. Mail either addressed to or intercepted by the office is often temporally sensitive, and as such, impact must be minimized to limit changes. The possibility of the information being used to alter present-day events detrimentally must also be weighed. Using the information given by SCP-130 to alter events requires a two-thirds supermajority vote by the overseers. Examples of intercepted messages are stored within Document 131. Mail with the following code phrase are to be immediately delivered after screening, without being read by 5/130. After so doing, that code phrase is to be invalidated, and the next one brought in line. Procedure Franklin 17. All outgoing mail is to be sent with appropriate current postage at the time of sending, and must be marked with a suitable code phrase. The mail sent by this method is to be logged, then cross-checked with past parcels, to ensure temporal integrity. Upon attempt at mailing, should a receipt appear for postage due, the amount shall be placed in an envelope and put in the outgoing mail slot. The slot will accept the following currencies: rands, euros, and the use of counterfeit currencies will result in a lethal reaction by SCP-130, and an additional fine will be levied until mail can be sent again. Addendum 133. Incident 136. On a package arrived with the address for a post office box at the site. Dr. the researcher assigned to SCP-130, placed the parcel into the POB and waited. Several minutes later, an unknown person walked into the lobby. The subject appeared to be briefly puzzled and walked over to the box. The locked box opened at his touch, and he expressed surprise at seeing the parcel with his name on it. MTF Alpha 4, being on site, was dispatched to investigate once the subject was out of sight of SCP-130 and subsequently interviewed. The subject had no plans to visit that day, but had felt an unexplained desire to go there while driving nearby to visit family in the area. Upon opening the package, data expunged. A Class A amnestic was administered to the subject and was released after memory insertion. Document 131. Executive Summary of Instances, SCP-132. To this date, there have been several instances of SCP-132 that fall under Procedure Franklin 16, and with certain exceptions, all have been reviewed by this office. Below are brief summaries of sampled parcels addressed to persons of note, both within and outside of the Foundation. Dr. M.E., 5/130. Addressee, Dr. Alto Clef. Summary. To this date, Dr. Clef has had several parcels addressed to him in a variety of fashions, up to using valid code phrases per Procedure Franklin 16. In each and every case, these parcels have contained a wide variety of means to assassinate the good doctor, tied with either gloating, terse judgments, or even apologies. Notes. After many deaths and dollars worth of damage to Foundation material, all missives addressed to Dr. Clef are to be thoroughly scanned and opened by remote under Hazmat 3 conditions. Due to the incident on only D-Class personnel should handle the mail and be within 50 meters until disposed of. Addressee, Dr. Agatha Wrights. Summary. Dr. Wrights has had a variety of greeting cards sent to her, denoting such things as birthdays, anniversaries, and holidays such as Mother's Day from undisclosed recipients. Notes. Due to all such parcels are to be incinerated, and under no circumstances are they to be mentioned to Dr. Wrights. Addressee, Dr. King. Summary. Each Arbor Day for the past several years, a variety of apple-based products have been mailed to Dr. King, including seeds, cider, and brandy. Every September 26th, a biography of John Chapman, aka Johnny Appleseed, has appeared. Notes. Christ, what did this guy do to SCP-130? I don't even think he's been to South Africa. 5/130.
Item number, SCP-176. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. SCP-176 is contained on-site, under the cover of industrial chemical contamination. Any civilians attempting to enter SCP-176 must be detained. Multiple high-speed cameras are set up within the observation room and linked to continuously running analysis computers. If any deviation is observed in the recorded sequence, all recorded data must be immediately backed up and senior staff notified. Description. SCP-176 is an abandoned chemical factory situated near Data Expunged. The building consists of a factory floor and an observation room on the second floor, separated from the main room by one-way mirrors. There are three entrances to the building. A three-bay loading dock, whose doors have been welded shut. A ground floor employee entrance. A second floor observation room entrance, accessible via a metal staircase on the north end of the building. When the main building is entered via the loading dock or employee entrance, no anomalies are observed, merely an empty room in severe disuse and disrepair, with a small amount of metallic debris consistent with a stripped-down, abandoned factory. The inside staircase leading up to the observation room is missing and inaccessible, and so far, every attempt to enter the observation room via the inside of the factory through the access door or windows has failed. When the observation room is entered via the second floor outside door, a factory observation room consistent in disuse and disrepair to the rest of the building is found. However, when the factory floor is viewed through the observation room windows, the anomalous property of SCP-176 is visible. The view from the observation room window shows a static repeating scene that lasts approximately 11.3 seconds before repeating. Visible through the window is a room of the same dimensions and layout as the factory floor, but painted white and sterilized. Set up in the middle of the room is a huge electronic device of indeterminate function, covering at least 50 square meters, and extending approximately 2 meters in height at its highest point. Five individuals in white clean suits appear to be working on the device. Approximately 5.9 seconds into the scene, the employee entrance door bursts open, and four individuals, wearing black tactical armor with no identifying marks or emblems, enter the room and open fire on the research personnel. At 11.3 seconds, the device in the center of the room emits an intense flash of light and radiation, and the scene resets. Analysis of thousands of instances of the scene has shown no variation in the sequence. So far, all attempts at interacting with the scene have failed. Any attempts to breach the window or door from within the observation room are met with resistance, inconsistent with the suggested strength of the materials comprising their frames. To date, all attempts that have resulted in successful penetration of the door or window have resulted in the damage being instantly reverted, along with the sequence during the burst of light. Any tools or limbs extended outside of the observation room are cleanly severed and have never been found. Research is ongoing into the nature of the device at the center of SCP-176, as well as the identities of the individuals involved. Addendum 176-1. Further analysis of individuals in SCP-176. Analysis has yielded the following information regarding the individuals visible in the scene. Unidentified researcher number 1. Male Caucasian, approximately 40 years of age, with brown hair and green eyes. Stands in the southeast corner of the room, reading from a standing monitor. Hit 3 times in the chest by automatic fire at approximately 8.1 seconds. And appears to be killed instantly. Unidentified researcher number 2. Male, Asian, approximately 35 years of age, with black hair and brown eyes. Stands to the left of researcher number 1, carries a clipboard with indecipherable writing on a notepad. Hit once in right shoulder at 8 seconds, before dropping to the floor, out of sight behind the device. Unidentified researcher number 3. Female Caucasian, approximately 40 years of age, with brown hair and amber eyes. Sits at a desk in the southwest corner of the room, working at a computer station. Is out of the line of sight when the gunfire begins, and takes cover under the desk. Appears to be reaching for a weapon of some sort shortly before the end of the sequence. Unidentified researcher number 4. Male, Caucasian, approximately 45 years of age, with brown hair and indeterminate eyes. Stands in front of the device to the northeast, with his back to the observation room. Shot twice in the head at 7.2 seconds, killed instantly. Unidentified researcher number 5. Male, indeterminate. Stands in the northwest corner, mostly obscured. Presumably shot at approximately 7.8 seconds and drops down, out of sight. Unidentified assailant number 1. Male, indeterminate. Wielding a suppressed M4A1. Enters first, shoots researcher number 4 and researcher number 5, then moves toward the device. Unidentified assailant number 2. Male, indeterminate, wielding a suppressed MP5N. Enters second, turns left and shoots researcher number 1 and researcher number 2, then sweeps toward the southeast. Unidentified assailant number 3. Male, indeterminate, wielding a suppressed MP5N. Enters third, turns right and moves under the observation room. Unidentified assailant number 4. Male, indeterminate, wielding a suppressed TMP. Stays at the door, covering the others.
Item number, SCP-112. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. SCP-112 is contained within an abandoned amusement park, designated site. Said site is to be staffed with a standard complement of 12 armed guards in designated amusatastic land garb to prevent civilian interference. SCP-112's power supply is housed within a standard Foundation prefab building with 2i security door locks and a standard staff of 6 security staff and 1 operator. Since all other rides in site are intentionally disabled, civilian intervention is low. As the anomalous properties of SCP-112 occur regardless of its condition, only mandatory maintenance work is to be done on SCP-112. This also ensures that local civilians treat SCP-112 and its surroundings as abandoned and ignored. All tests involving SCP-112 must be conducted with a portable toilet nearby, as well as a small table with basic food and drink items. Description.
SCP-112 is a steel sit-down roller coaster, formerly known as the Blue Steel Surfer. Built in SCP-112 was marketed as the crown jewel of the amusement park. Initial testing of the ride resulted in extremely negative experiences from testing staff. When these reports became public knowledge, the financial repercussions of the failure of the Steel Surfer resulted in the parent company of the amusement park going bankrupt. The property was abandoned and undisturbed until a local gang broke into the park and reactivated the improperly disabled rides, SCP-112 included. When police attempted to arrest the members who were exiting SCP-112 after its inaugural ride, the riders began to attracting local media attention. Suspecting the ride had traits within its mandate, the Foundation purchased the park under the auspices of rebuilding the park as a Musetastic land in order to test any potential anomalous properties from the ride. When SCP-112 is started, the ride functions as expected until Point Alpha, its primary drop. When a car reaches Point Alpha, the train vanishes. After 3 minutes, the estimated time the train would normally take, the train rematerializes at Point Omega, 3 meters from the coaster's starting point. Human subjects riding SCP-112 have a drastically different experience compared to outside observation. The time frame between Point Alpha and Point Omega is massively extended, with subjective ride times ranging from 4 minutes to several months. The properties of the ride also vary from person to person. Most subjects report elements on the ride that do not exist on the ride proper, like bat wings, cobra rolls, and inclined loops. Subjects do not have any sense that the rest of the world is alien or otherwise different. Only the ride experience is different. Upon exiting the ride, subjects typically experience feelings of confusion and ill health, depending on the subjective time they spent riding SCP-112. These feelings are based not on any physical maladies, but the subjective experience of dealing with a physical malady for an extended period of time. For example, a subject with a subjective ride time of 3 days may experience confusion that he had strong feelings of hunger for most of his ride, but at the end of the ride, he was not hungry at all. Addendum A. Assorted Experiments. Experiment 11234534. Subject, D-34534. D-34534 was sent on SCP-112 at 2:42 p.m. The train reached Point Alpha at 2:43 p.m., rematerialization at 2:46 p.m. Upon exiting SCP-112, D-34534 quietly asked for aspirin before passing out. Upon revival and medication, D-34534 reported a subjective ride time of 36 minutes, with multiple loops and twists not found on SCP-112's architecture. Experiment 11267564. Subject, D-67564. D-67564 was sent on SCP-112 at 1:30 p.m. The train reached Point Alpha at 1:31 p.m. Rematerialization at 1:34 p.m. D-67564 reported a subjective ride time of 4 minutes, which D-67564 reported as enjoyable, with the exception of that part where the car jumps off the track and lands right before the loop. Experiment 112-5893. Subject, D-5893. D-5893 was sent on SCP-112 at 12:30 p.m. The train reached Point Alpha at 12:31 p.m. Rematerialization at 12:34 p.m. At the end of the ride, D-5893 immediately ran to the table with consumables, wordlessly consuming everything he could grab onto, including the wrappers of previously consumed food objects. D-5893 became violent when Foundation staff attempted to subdue him, even going so far as to expunge. Upon capture and interviewing, D-5893 remained confused and disoriented, continuously saying the phrases, "No food till the ride is over," "Let me sleep," "Let the spinning stop," and 152 lights. The Foundation believes that D-5893's statements imply that his subjective ride time was approximately 5 months long, and during his trip he experienced 5 months worth of malnutrition and exhaustion, despite no physical proof of these experiences found. Experiment 112-7556. Subject, D-7556, one standard issue camera facing D-7556. D-7556 was sent on SCP-112 at 11:36 a.m. The train reached Point Alpha at 11:37 a.m. Rematerialization at 11:40 a.m. D-7556 experienced symptoms similar, but muted, to those of D-5893. During the interview, D-7556 explained that his subjective ride time was 1 month and 6 days long. During his trip, he was unable to eat or sleep, and suffered major headaches from SCP-112. D-7556 reported experiencing every sort of roller coaster element currently in use, and a few believed to be conceptual. Camera footage lasting 3 minutes shows D-7556 sobbing for the duration of the ride, with movement consistent with SCP-112's physical track. Addendum B. Rider Interviews. Experiment 112-35784-23512. Post-ride interview 1. Subject: D-35784. Interviewer: Dr. Interview type: post-ride interview. Doctor: how are you feeling, 35784? D-35784 rolls eyes. I'm fine. It was just a roller coaster ride, dude. Maybe you have me confused with the other guy. You know, the one that attacked when the ride was over. Doctor: I will. In time. Describe your experience on SCP-112, please. D-35784 laughs. What's there to say? Before I was sent to jail, I designed coasters. A couple minutes too long of a ride, you always gotta worry about that. But the twists that thing has are damn good. A few of them I'm pretty sure I mocked up back in the day. It would have been a lot better if the next to me wasn't acting like a damn fool. Doctor: D-23512. What was he doing? D-35784 sighs. It's what he wasn't doing that pissed me off. He was slouched over so much that his restraints were taut, just facing forward. Think his mouth was open the entire time. If it were possible, I'd say he looked like someone who had been on a crying jag for a few hours. I don't know. When we got that slow point before the banked curve, I tried snapping my fingers in front of him. Idiot just barely turned to face me. And you know what happened afterwards. Doctor: yes, he punched you. D-35784: not really a punch, really. Slapped me, shaking me, trying to choke me. I didn't get the impression that he really wanted to kill me, just wanted to get an answer out of me. That's what he said, actually. Shit, like, why didn't you look at me, and why did you not stop cheering the whole time, in a very hoarse voice? Was in mid-question with another when the guards introduced their rifles to the back of his head. Experiment 112-35784-23512. Post-ride interview 2. Subject: D-23512. Interviewer: Dr. Interview type: post-ride interview. Forward: this interview was conducted 3 weeks after riding on SCP-112 with D-35784. D-23512 is not willing to speak verbally since his ride. From time to time he attempts to speak, but shows signs of discomfort and pain in doing so, stating that his throat is too sore to talk. While there are no medical issues with D-23512, his experiences have obviously left him traumatized from his experience on SCP-112. Dr. estimates a full recovery is possible before monthly terminations, and at such time he will be capable of estimating precisely how long his subjective ride time was. This interview was conducted through written communication. Given his fixation on certain traits of the ride, this transcript has been edited for brevity. Doctor: hello, 23512. How are you feeling? D-23512: still hurts. Still dizzy. Loops and loops. Spins, spins, spins. Forever and ever. Doctor: why do you say your throat hurts? D-23512: screamed. Screamed over and over. Girl wouldn't answer me. She never looked at me. I screamed and screamed till I couldn't scream anymore. Throat got better. Screamed again. Never looked, never noticed. Just kept cheering the hell of ups and downs and ups and side to side and side to side. Doctor: I'm assuming you're talking about the person who went on the ride with you. 35784. D-23512. Girl with the big jiggling tits. Cheered and laughed and cheered and laughed. Every spin, every turn, every twist, even when it got dark,
I could hear her laughing and wooing. Couldn't sleep because of her laughing and cheering. Light and day, bright and dark, always screaming and giggling. How could she do that? Doctor, she told me you were just sitting there, staring ahead. She said she tried to get your attention, but you never responded. D23512. I waved and shook her. She didn't move, didn't notice, just kept cheering. Tried to tune her out for a few months at a time, but she never noticed me. Kept cheering, kept screaming, kept laughing at me as I starved and peed myself and slammed my head against the side till I bled. Just kept laughing and screaming through the loops and the spins and the deep dark dips that never ended, never stopped crushing. Doctor, 23512. I'm trying to help you, but acting insane won't help you in the least. There was no injury to your head at the end of the ride. D23512. I felt it. The warm on my head till it got cold and stopped spilling. Still itches. Doctor, so what happened at the end of the ride? You had a bit of an issue with 35784. D23512. She stopped laughing and giggling after all that time, and she looks at me and smiles and says, "Nice ride, eh?" And I shook her and tried to ask her why she wouldn't stop laughing and screaming. I didn't want to hurt her. Not really. Just wanted to know why. Why? 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 Repeats several times till 23512 is disabled.
Lesson complete. To continue with your orientation training, subscribe to SCP Orientation right now and make sure you don't miss any of our upcoming videos.